You're watching Kenosha Community Television.
It's pretty amazing when you consider that 7 years ago, we didn't have the treatments we have now. We cure 80% of children with cancer. If you think about that, I mean, go back 50 years, we were curing 20 to 30%. This is the miracle story of modern medicine. We understand what makes this cancer tick. And of course, without donors from around the world, this just couldn't happen. And there's one thing we're focused on here at St. Jude, and that's beating this thing.
Okay, out in the woods in the city of Kenosha here at the Gateway Technical College, we're here to celebrate another Earth Day event. I'm Dean Romano, and it's time for Outdoor Wild. I'm here with Kevin from Cassidy Tree Service, and there's a good reason for that, because they do a lot of removing of trees, and some of them are the ash trees affected by the emerald ash borer beetle, correct?
That's correct, yeah. There's emerald ash borer is really spread through our area now, and there's a lot of trees suffering from it. So it's very important to get those trees removed as soon as possible.
Well, you know, Kevin, there's I know through the city of Kenosha here, and probably all over the place, they're just removing hundreds of trees that have been affected by this beetle. And I understand they affect the ash trees. So what, they remove the ash trees so they don't get into other trees, or is it just the ash trees they affect?
That's primarily the ash trees that they affect. They will get into white fringe tree as well, but that is more of an ornamental that you might find tucked away in somebody's garden. So once those impacted ash are removed, then hopefully the beetle will move on and be about its way.
Okay, well, you know, Kevin, too, you were earlier I had seen you, and you had said something that you discovered that they're doing something to the stump that goes down in the ground or something that the ash borer is affecting.
I have found that after ash trees stay dead for a year or two, they really start to develop armillaria root rot. The problem with that is that impacts the soil line of the tree. And it basically turns all the supportive structures below ground into basically styrofoam. So I see a lot of the older trees that have been standing dead for a little while start to uproot in entirety. So it can become a dangerous situation if those trees are around your house or near a public area.
Okay. Well, I'm glad you told us that, because I have one in front of my home, in front of our home. And it's going to have to be removed, because it is going to eventually, it's going. And I know that when people get them, they're not sure, they don't die off right away. They take a little while, but probably they can go like within 2 years or less than 2 years. Is that correct?
Yeah, the ash borer has actually been in the tree probably longer than you realize. Once you start seeing the symptoms, then you may still have a chance to treat the tree and keep it around. But in a lot of cases, especially down in the Kenosha Pleasant Prairie area, moving up even into Waterford and Racine, I'm really starting to see trees. If you haven't treated them yet, it's almost too late. So having them inspected by a professional arborist is the way to go.
And that's what you do.
That's what I do, yeah.
All right, and that is Cassidy Tree Service.
Cassidy Tree Service.
What's your website again?
That's www.cassidytreeservice.com.
Okay, and let's just show the folks a piece of bark and show them what the emerald ash borer beetle does.
So this is a piece of exterior bark. So the ash borer lives in between this bark and the woody tissue. And I don't know if the camera can see the larval galleries down in there, but what happens is the larva burrow through this and they tunnel through, and this is exactly where the tree is transporting all of its water and all of its nutrients.
Okay.
So once that channel has been compromised, the tree can no longer move food down from the leaves to the roots, and it can't move water up from the roots to the leaves. So the tree effectively dies through dehydration.
Okay. And also, so people know too, they can spot some of that, because what happens is some of them branches that are extended from that ash tree, they start growing little branches off them, right? Little tiny roots.
Right. They're called epicormic shoots, and you will see some of that shooting coming out. Now, that can also be a response to a heavily pruned tree. What I see more is, what I look for in the winter is woodpecker damage. So as the woodpeckers are going after those borers, they're going to peel off little barks of this ash, the plates. And so it's going to leave a lighter pattern on there. So you'll notice a lot of woodpeckers on your tree, a lot of that white, we call it flecking, up in the upper canopy. They always say look for those D-shaped exit holes. By the time you see those at eye level, that tree is pretty well gone. So.
Yeah, I've got some of that. So ours is definitely an ash tree. Well, Kevin, I really thank you for doing this.
Oh, thanks a lot. I appreciate it.
Oh, you bet it, buddy. We'll talk to you very soon.
All right, take care.
All right, I'm here with Dan from Hawthorne Hollow, and you may have seen us on Daily Motion TV, maybe a couple other places. If not, check us out. But Dan, let's talk a little more about your nature sanctuary.
So what we're doing next week is our annual garlic mustard pull. And so we've been doing this pull party for about 4 years. And I don't know, maybe some of your viewers know about garlic mustard as an invasive species. One of the problems is they germinate and grow much earlier than most of the other native plants, and then they drop their seed and they drop it, so these patches grow really densely. And if you don't pull it out, you don't get the native flowers coming in the spring. So after a few years, it'll just fill in with garlic mustard. So every year we've been pulling, and everybody comes out and volunteers. We pull for about 2 hours, and then we actually make food out of the garlic mustard, and we have a big lunch, and we feed everybody. You can kind of switch it for spinach. So we have like garlic mustard lasagna, garlic mustard pizza, garlic mustard quiche. You know, we feed everybody. Everybody just sits around and eats this stuff. So it's a pretty good day. It's a lot of fun. It's, again, we're getting to be bigger and bigger. We're up to about 24 people a year now will come out, and hopefully we can grow more. I mean, it's a good time of year to do it. The seed, it hasn't started dropping seed yet. So the timing is just right to make the biggest impact.
Yeah. Well, you know, Dan, what's really cool about that is we were just involved with the garlic mustard pole before I came in here along the Pike River. And I think it's really neat. A lot of people don't realize you can make food out of that stuff. And that's cool.
I think that's why it was here originally, is because it was a type of food. But the problem is it just grows so densely that it chokes out the native species. Like, I think somebody brought it from Europe as something to eat and to grow in gardens, but it just spreads and it chokes out the native wild plants. So
I think that's a lot of our problem with conservation. I think a lot of folks don't realize that some of these plants that are removed are invasive and brought over years ago from, you know, other countries.
We've got a similar problem. It's a type of daisy up in the prairies at Hawthorne Hollow that was brought because they looked nice, but the way they distribute their seeds and the birds don't eat them as much, they'll grow out and they'll choke out the native prairie plants too. So it's a lot of management that goes involved once you let these invasives through. I mean, you have to remove them, but there's a lot of seeds in the seed bank that are just hard to eliminate.
I know you and I covered some of that, and folks can check us out on the Daily Motion TV online. And I know you got other things going on with Hawthorne Hollow. How's the bat situation? You guys are doing the bat houses.
Well,
what's going on with that?
We still have bat houses. I don't know. Maybe I can show you this thing. Got both the kits and ones that are all pre-built. Okay. You can see inside there. This is a type of material that the bats can climb onto, and there's multiple layers down inside there. That's actually where the bats will go in and nest. Of course, you need some kind of ventilation, but they go up, and this thing always is facing south. It'll get warm, and they kind of like hang out in there at night. Well, they don't winter over in these boxes. This is just kind of like for little colonies to develop and breed in, and they'll rear their young. And usually, even in Wisconsin, they're still eventually migrating to where there are caves, and they're still overwintering in caves. But having places to nest really helps them to have a place to reproduce. So this is originally from a DNR project that was sort of promoting bat houses and like counting bats before the white nose syndrome came through. And so I don't know the status of it now, but we still have a few of the bats left, bat houses left over.
Okay.
And we're actually featuring a bat walk class, I think this September. It's in our new series, which you can see on the website. So
that's a pretty cool idea. Now, just so people know, there some people may not understand what is the purpose of saving bats. Well, why don't we tell them that?
Well, I mean, bats are the number one thing that's taking care of mosquitoes.
Right.
You don't want to be overrun by mosquitoes, especially. I mean, the next thing around is the Zika virus,
right,
which hopefully won't be affecting us as much in the Midwest, but These are things that are really keeping the insect populations down. They eat tons and tons and tons of insects every year. And without them, you'd kind of be overrun.
Are they also some type kind of a pollinator?
Certain bats can be when they're going after, they'll like pollinate the fruit. If they're after nectar, these are usually the smaller species. I'm not sure how many different species are in Wisconsin.
Yeah.
But they're all kind of susceptible to the white nose syndrome.
Well, it's really great, you know, that you fill us in with this knowledge. And also, let's let the folks know Hawthorne Hollow has things to offer for people. You got popcorn seed, you got syrup.
So we grow popcorn hopefully every year now. It's heirloom popcorn, which it's hard to come by organic popcorn because it's one of the main crops that's Roundup ready is corn and soy. We have our bird lovers series, so we've got every month something for birds, and we're just coming up on the bird walk program. I'll hold it up so you can get a view of the bird walk program here. The bird walks are complimentary, but the other classes, depending on if you're a member, there's discounts. But we've really got something every month for the bird lovers. Of course, we still sell our maple syrup that we make in March, and we just have a little bookstore open from the Two Sisters Boutique.
Good.
So that's what we're doing here at Earth Day. Don't forget to tell people about the concert series.
Yeah.
We've got our poster for the concert series.
Let's tell them real quick so they do know.
So our Pike River Benefit Series, three different Fridays during the summer. We work in the old amphitheater, the Two Sisters Amphitheater, and we have local bands play. They do a three-hour show. There's food, brews, wine, you know, it's a good little festival just for a night, for three nights during the summer. So,
all right, sounds like a good thing. All right, we got to get some of that garlic mustard.
Oh, yeah,
I'm gonna keep TJ on his toes this week, and I will talk to my camera guy, see if he's got a shot. All right, I'm here with Tim, and Tim, you are with the, okay, you got Farm Fresh Atlas in front of us, but you're with the farming community or something for
pretty much the Farm Fresh Atlas this time. Okay. Yeah, okay. I'm a member of the beekeepers too, but this is what I'm promoting this time. It's a local food guide.
Okay.
We have all of the farmers markets listed in the area, as well as CSAs and farms, restaurants, and businesses that support sustainable agriculture in the area. So it's a publication that you can hang on to and keep for the year and utilize. We also, we're on Facebook, and we have a website as well.
Oh, you do? Okay. Do you know the address of the website? I mean, the website.
The website, if you just Google Farm Fresh Atlas, Southeast Wisconsin, you'll fall into it.
You bet. Absolutely.
Yep.
Well, that's really cool. So now you guys, you do a lot of the food growing, and they do. This thing gets to this lets the people know where everything is.
Exactly. We're just a connection between farms and people interested in real food.
Yeah. And nowadays that is a problem because they're so concerned with what's going on out there with the foods, and that's why a lot of people are doing this, and it's a good thing.
You bet. It's a growing interest, and we're glad to be on the edge of it, and we're growing, so it's exciting.
You know what I see on the benefit side of this? Less pesticides that are killing our bees.
Right, absolutely. Yep, that's part of the thing. And, you know, more food-related crops as opposed to the other kind.
Right.
Yeah.
And also, too, Tim, with that thought in mind about less pesticides on the bees, if people don't realize, we got to have them bees. And I think the mortality is around 47%.
It's getting in that area. We're also concerned about native pollinators, the native bees, which are we don't know that much about, but they actually perform a huge service in local pollination, more so than the honeybees, actually. So,
my wife walking around over here, she's keeping an eye on me.
Yep, as is mine.
As yours. Well, you know, the thing is, with those bees, now I'm surprised because a lot of people don't realize other bees besides honeybees are pollinators.
Absolutely. In a local area, about 75% of pollination of gardens is native bees. Over 3,000 varieties of them, and they're not generalists like honeybees. They come out during a particular time of the year pollinate a specific flower and then go back into hibernation. Bumblebees, on the other hand, are a generalist. They pollinate a lot of things.
We're talking about the pollinators now, and the one thing is, this all relates to food. It relates to everything we do.
Absolutely. You betcha. Yep. So if we can encourage people to support our local food growers and farmers, and that's awesome.
Yeah, yep. That is awesome. We'll get this on there for sure. And also, I do want folks to know with the pollinators that it's not just bees. We were just talking with Dan from Hawthorne. There's bats that help a little bit.
Yep.
There's a lot of monarchs. Another thing.
The butterflies. They
urge people to plant milkweed pods.
Sure.
That helps bring the monarchs back.
Yep.
There are things, and I know a lot of people don't know, but if you go online and do some research, but yeah, monarchs, bats, bees, them are all important to keep human life alive.
Absolutely. You bet.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm standing here with Carl, and he is with the Beekeepers Association here in Kenosha, Wisconsin.
Racine, Kenosha.
Okay.
Beekeeping Club.
Now, Carl, what have you heard about the bees? The mortality was about 40%, 7% down. Is that about accurate, or do you have any?
I think it's pretty accurate, yeah.
So what folks can do to help save bees is one thing they can do is they can get involved in beekeepers and become a beekeeper, right?
That would help, more people getting involved with it, Again, more forage for them. They have a hard time surviving in a cornfield or soybean field.
Well, I think what folks need to know too, Carl, is that and we've talked about this already once or twice, but they have to realize that bees are very, very important in our society. If bees go, we're done.
If we don't have bees, we don't get many apples and cucumbers and muskmelons and so on, watermelons.
Well, they definitely are a big part of the food chain because they everything that they pollinate also goes into feeding of livestock and things like that, which is, there's your beef, there's your, there's tons of stuff that they pollinate that really, with the transfers of all these plants, without that, a lot of food is going to disappear.
Yeah. The bees pollinate like onions. And they do alfalfa, the big seed growers have them, again with the canola oil, they use the bees for pollinating their plants.
Right.
And the bee has something specific to it. It stays with one type of flower. When it starts to pollinate, it don't run all over the place. One kind of flower, so you get, in apple orchards, you get a good cross-pollination going on.
And the honey from them is delicious, and it's good for you?
Honey is beneficial. It has a lot of trace minerals in it.
Right. Plus it lasts. Now, so folks know, you don't have to throw that honey away. Honey lasts for thousands of years.
It will last a long time if you keep it pretty much like, I guess it's around 70 degrees.
Yeah, okay.
It will eventually crystallize. That's normal.
Right.
But if you heat it up, with no higher than 120 degrees, in a water bath, you can make it liquid again.
Right.
Or you can use it if it's for a cup of tea. You just scoop it out when it's crystallized.
You can put it in tea or, any warm drink. But the nice thing is about even crystallized honey is you can still consume it. It ain't going to hurt you.
No, it's not going to hurt you.
Now, also the thing with bees is that farming them is a good idea, but people can do other things to help keep them alive. Less pesticides, the toxic pesticides they believe are killing them.
If you look what people have, a green lawn with no flowers in, the bees don't have any benefits. If you leave the lawn grow for a while, they have the benefit of the dandelions and certain weeds in there. I always grow my lawn up to 6 inches the first time.
Okay. And
then the dandelions have to reach up for the light, and when I cut them off, they're nearly gone most of the time.
Right. Yeah, a lot of people don't realize, but those things are important. And it's beneficial more than it's not. And people, that's something that people should know.
Mm-hmm.
Letting the lawn grow the first time, 6 inches, that's fine. And getting some of them dandelions in there, that's okay. It's not going to harm anything. And the pesticides we're talking about, they're now coming out with other things that you can use that's not so toxic that help kill off these creatures that keep man alive.
Mm-hmm. You know? If you look at a lot of farm fields in the old years gone by, you would see dandelions grow before they could have crop in seeded, you know, soya beans, corn. Right. Today it's a barren field, you see, so there's no pasture for the bees to be had there.
Well, you know, Albert Einstein prediction was, and I didn't know Albert Einstein predicted it, but I read that he did, and it was supposedly if bees die completely, man has about 4 years left on the face of the planet.
I read that one too, and it's quite a scary one, that one.
Yeah. So we need to keep bees going, folks.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Carl, I really thank you for all this.
I recommend, you know, if they live here, that they can join, you know, if they're interested, they can go to the Kenosha County Beekeepers Club.
Okay.
It meets out on 50 and the county seat.
Absolutely.
They can find it on the internet, you know,
sure.
Meeting dates and time.
I will, do you have one of them? I'll take it with me. I'll post this information for folks to find if they want to join or become a bee member or even join and just learn about them or whatever they have to do so we can help save these animals or these insects.
Nine or ten meetings a year in the club.
Wonderful. I'll see if I can get in on some of them. I'm tied up with a lot of meetings these days. Conservation Congress being one, I like to go to their meetings.
Yeah. Some of them are interested in, you know, and if you go to the meetings, you can always meet somebody that can answer your questions.
Sure. Good thing for the public to get involved in.
Mm-hmm.
Carl, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
I'm here with Jane from Gateway Technical College. And Jane, what are you doing here today?
Well, you know, Gateway is very committed to the environment, and we try to have curriculum that surrounds careers that deal with environmental things such as sustainable energy systems. We also have improved our operations through lighting and heating and cooling to be more environmentally friendly so we can reduce our carbon footprint. But a third aspect to that is community education, and we have Celebrate Earth Day events at both the Kenosha and Elkhorn campuses, and then we also do an EcoFest Racine on our Racine campus in order to bring the community in and have them learn more about what they can do to improve the environment.
Right now, it's been getting better year after year as we go.
Yeah, I think we're in year 8. First, this is the best weather we've ever had. Yeehaw! But right, we have 3 areas on our campus, and each one of them has grown. One of the best things that has happened is that we've partnered with Mahone Middle School, and Mahone has provided, I think there's something like 50 of their students on campus today. They have science projects. They have some of their clubs, the STEM Club, the Bonsai Club, their performing arts group, and each one of them has an environmental message with their projects that they've brought. They're serving as greeters. They've just done a wonderful job of partnering with Gateway on this.
That's phenomenal. And with the young students involved, that's a great way to get them interested in what's going on our planet.
That's for sure. And you can tell that they really care and they want to learn and they also want to help other people learn. They have some fabulous science projects that as soon as I'm done running around like a crazy person, I'm really looking forward to learning more about them. The alternative energy research that they've done, very good.
For sure. A lot of the reasons that we cover this, of course, you know I do the conservation.
Exactly.
And in my mind, it's very important to bring this message to the public because really it's all tied in.
It certainly is. And then I'm sure you found it very interesting to talk with people from the Kenosha Water Utility and what they do to improve the water quality and that we have some of the best water, I think, in the entire country, from what I understand. The Kenosha Public Museum is here educating people on the fish of the Great Lakes. If you go up to the Center for Sustainable Living, you're learning about trees and things that are either made from trees or live in trees. And of course, the cute animals from Bong Recreation Area. I always enjoy that as well. You learn and you're having fun. What better?
Exactly, exactly. Now, one of the things too, and just very quickly, you guys had a tree here last year, and Jason and I covered that for the
survivor tree.
And that's still here, correct? That's from the 2011 attack of the towers.
Definitely, yes. That was so fascinating. It was a project, that, and I can't recall the name of the organization out east that took it on, but they created grafts and seedlings from a tree that survived the bombing of the Twin Towers. Okay. It was the last tree standing, basically. And they created grafts of that, and those entities across the country who had another piece of the Twin Towers. When we have a crossbar, some rebar that came from the Twin Towers out at our Hero Center in Burlington, okay, because we've already been involved in that, they allowed us to have one of the seedlings. So we have a tree that continues to grow and become stronger, and it is truly a survivor tree of that that horrible incident.
Correct, correct. And it was quite an event here last year with that tree. And now, does that tree still have a medallion hanging on it?
You're asking me a question I don't know. Okay. So okay. I'm sorry, I don't know that.
That's okay. But we want to get it. What I want to do is we're going to get a shot of that tree. I want
sure.
people to see that.
Yeah, and I can't. I think the medallion was taken off just because it was winter, and
okay,
I'm not sure that it was put back on
that's
for
okay,
today.
But it is here. It's over there, and we should recognize it. It's not the smallest tree, probably, right?
It probably is the smallest tree, and I believe that it does have the marking there, the permanent marking that explains what it is.
Oh, wonderful. Okay, yeah, we'll get a shot of that for sure. And it was quite an honor because there was quite an event last year. I mean, they were really celebrating that big time.
Yes, that's for sure. It was very moving.
Right.
It means a lot to veterans who have defended our country against incidents like this occurring.
Right.
And it's a great tribute to our veterans, a tribute to America for standing tall during this adverse period of time.
Right, right. And, you know, what really makes me very proud and happy is that Jason, I think, was probably the only show that covered this on this show.
I totally agree with that, yes. No, you're always right here with us. We appreciate the partnership.
That's okay. We appreciate it. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you, Dean. Take care.
You bet. Okay, a little bit ago, Jane was telling us Mahone Middle School is here at the Earth Day event at Gateway Tech, and I'm with Celeste, correct?
Yeah.
Okay, well, Celeste, tell us a little bit about what you got going on here. I see the pine cones, I see the seeds.
Yeah, we're making pine cone bird feeders. So what we're doing is we're taking pine cones and we're rubbing lard and oatmeal on them, and then we're rolling them in bird seeds.
Okay, that feed the birds.
Yeah.
All right, so these people take these pine cones, they do this, and they just hang them from their trees?
Uh-huh.
That's kind of a cool idea.
Yeah, it hangs from the trees, so that way, like, the squirrels don't get it so much.
Yeah. All right, so... Oh, yeah. Okay, so that could always be an issue. The squirrels are going to go.
Yeah.
Okay, and what is the purpose of this project? It's to feed the birds and to get younger people interested in helping out.
Yeah, it's like everything's like natural, so it's not like using a bunch of other like resources or whatever.
Right.
So it's like recycling other things that come from the trees and then feeding the animals.
All right, well, it sounds like a pretty cool project. So now, is this the only thing that you guys are involved in here right now? Or
This is what we're doing, but they've got like a lot of other projects over there. Over there, they're using t-shirts to make dog toys.
Oh, okay. All right, that's pretty cool. So a lot of this is Mahone in here then?
Yeah.
Right? Oh,
uh-huh.
All right. That sounds pretty interesting.
Mm-hmm. We've got the Eco Club and then the Generosity Club, too.
All right. Well, that sounds pretty good. Well, we're going to kind of look around and see what you have here and enjoy the rest of the day.
Thank you. You too.
All right. I'm here with some of the students from Mahone Middle School here in Kenosha, Wisconsin. And we are we're a Generosity Club. Let's talk about it. Who first?
So we make dog toys out of old shirts.
Okay.
So what we do is, you know, we cut them into strips and we braid those strips and, you know, we tie them into knots and then, you know, you can play with your dogs with these and everything.
Well, here's a cool idea. What we're doing, when you guys start doing things like this, you're taking stuff that might go in the trash. Instead of going in the trash, it's being used again. So that helps a little bit in actually with our environment.
We're actually donating them to the Safe Harbor Society, and then we're going to go there in a couple of weeks to actually give them to the dogs.
Well, that's a great thing. So now, for those that may not know that might tune in, the Safe Harbor Society is a kennel here in Kenosha that takes animals, domestic animals. And correct?
Yes.
Okay. So are you having fun?
Yes. I love this.
Do I say something?
I enjoy this fair every single year, and I really like Generosity Club. It's really worth getting up in the morning.
Wonderful. Well, you guys look like you're having a great time, and you know, it looks like a lot of fun, and it's good for our environment. I see you got a little Earth sticker over there, so that's a good thing. Hi, what's your name?
My name is Cooper.
Cooper, you having a good time here today?
Yes.
Yeah. So, you put any of these together yourself?
Or? No, I don't know how very
okay.
much.
Well, you can supervise, right?
Yep. I can supervise.
You can supervise. Okay.
More.
Okay. All right. Well, it's nice to meet all of you. Okay. All right. Take care. Bye-bye. All right. I'm here with Pam from Mahone Middle School, correct?
Yep, that's correct. Hi, you guys. Nice to see you again. I wrote a book called Bag Ban Swoops into Crow Creek. It is about the dangers of plastic bags. And just to show you guys, I don't know if you can cue in on this at all. I took this picture yesterday. I live in the Forest Park neighborhood. And it's just so sad to see how many plastic bags are still in our trees in our neighborhood. These are hurting birds. It's making our environment look horrible. We've got to put an end to this in some way, shape, or form. My book provides a lot of different suggestions and opportunities as to how to reuse them. At the end of the book, it's a family kind of activity that you can do, where you can make a reusable t-shirt bag as well. So I'd love for you to either find me on Facebook at Pamela Domkowski or email me at PamelaRoseD@yahoo.com. I'll hook you up with a book or I'll come. I do also run an Earth Day, or I run the Eco Club at Mahone Middle School, so a lot of these are my student volunteers. I just have a passion for the environment and I want to spread that around as well. So thank you, Dean, for coming out today. It's always a pleasure to see you.
Thank you very much. This is phenomenal. Love it. And plastic is a big problem. People do have to realize it's getting serious.
Yeah.
We have to do something about it.
Yeah. We've got to make an end to it. And unfortunately, lawmakers in Wisconsin, they just are trying to, right now, place a ban on banning plastic bags, which we really need to put an end to, too, because that's not being progressive. That's not going anywhere. Earth Day started in 1970. With one of our Wisconsin senators to begin with. We've got to continue that tradition. We are at the forefront. We've got to do this.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Pam, thanks very much.
Definitely a pleasure. Always a pleasure to see you guys. Thank you.
Talk to you soon.
All right.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
Let's try this again. Good morning, class. That's more like it. This morning we're going to discuss the dangers of petroleum.
Really? It's not like we brought it.
Thank you for the observation, Calvin. It is true that us girls cannot and do not drive, yet petroleum use still affects us. Can anyone tell me what this is?
Okay, there was Mahone Middle School with the students involved, and now I'm sitting with Lisa and
Christina,
I'm sorry, and go ahead, you guys are here for what reason? This is Lincoln Middle School now, this is a different school, so let's talk about this.
Well, we're here with Lincoln Middle School to educate the public about the effects of road salt on the environment. As you know, in the city, we have just recently gone through a change in our snow plow procedures, which we're really happy about. Our students have spoken with the city alderman and the mayor. We've been invited to speak, and the mayor's actually come to our school because we're studying the effects that road salt's having on the entire global community, but it affects our plants. It's affecting all of our fresh water. It affects your pets when they're out for a walk. The unique thing about our project is we entered a contest with Samsung Corporation, a STEM science project that we did was road salt. There were 4,100 science teachers across the United States who entered this contest. And the contest involved a STEM science project that had to do with your environment. As you go on in the contest and you continue to make the next round or level, your school wins money for technology. So ultimately, our students kept winning the rounds of this contest with Samsung, and we made the top 15 in the United States out of those 4,100 schools who entered this contest. And our students were sent to New York to compete live on stage for $120,000 worth of technology. Out of the top 15 in the nation, we made the top 5. Made the top 15, which meant we won $40,000 worth of technology for Lincoln Middle School through our studies of road salt and the environment.
That sounds like quite a project. And do you, now the projects you're working on with some of these studies, do you see some kind of a solution for the road salt?
That's why we have our symbolic toolbox here, because there is no real good solution.
Right.
We studied so many alternatives, and every alternative has a drawback. Every alternative we have studied has another drawback. For example, in the city now we're using beet juice on the streets before a storm, which helps protect the roads. It's beet juice and salt brine. It works like Pam on a pan. So when you pre-spray the road before a storm, if you pre-spray with the beet juice and the salt brine, it works like Pam, where you can lift the snow off and it doesn't impact into the road. However, beet juice takes the oxygen out of fresh water. So when the snow and ice melt, it goes into the water, you're having an adverse effect on the wildlife. So every alternative we've studied has an adverse effect. Educating people is the key. When it is 13 below and people are trying to melt their ice on their sidewalks, they're dumping more salt and more salt and more salt, and it's not working. All we're doing essentially is just adding more salt to the environment. So once people understand that once you reach a certain temperature, you have to use an alternate solution, like a traction item, like sand or gravel. Some people use kitty litter. That's another alternative, but it also has another impact because it has bad chemicals in it. So if we use a toolbox approach and we approach the snow and salt according to the temperature or the wind factors, if you're talking about highway. So the more we educate people on the necessity of reducing the salt and choosing other alternatives based on the conditions and the temperature, the more we can help the environment.
Right, and that's the idea of you raising the funds to help with the studies and the research, try to come up with a solution, correct?
Correct. Well, the basis of our main goal is to educate people. A lot of people have no idea that salt is affecting our environment, our soil, our water, right here in our community. One of the things we connected with Flint, Michigan, because one of the problems with that water was the chemicals. Another problem with the water when they switched the water source was that river was really super high salinity. A lot of salt had gotten into that water. That really adds to corrosion. You can see it on our streets. Our streets are affected by it. We get the potholes, we get the cracks. The more salt we use, the more damage to our infrastructure. So we connected it to a lot of situations globally that are going on. And we have to worry about that here in our own community. And we studied the effects of it on Lincoln Lagoon across the street. In the beginning of the winter, we had environmental biologists from Carthage come to our school and work with our students. And we tested the water in the Lincoln Lagoon. And then we planted plants. And we used that water with our plants. And just in the beginning of the season, with the amount of salt that was already in the lagoon, it killed our plants within hours. So what's that doing to our fish and our bugs and our whole ecosystem? And that's just one little microscopic example. Salt, once it enters our soil, doesn't go away. And it just permeates into the soil and it affects everything that grows. So we studied how it affects monarch butterflies are being born deformed, because they're drinking the milkweed on the side of the road, which is where the salt runs into. As they drink the milkweed, from the milkweed, they're being born with deformed brains and the sizes are deformed. So it's starting to affect our whole environment.
And it still is important for people to grab milkweeds and plant them if they can and whatever, but that is the idea of raising the funds for the study and the research to see if we can't come up with a solution. And that's why we work on this year every year. And hopefully we will reach a solution somewhere.
We're working on it. Scientists are working on it. So far, all the solutions, as we said, have an adverse effect. So our main goal is to educate people on how to use less salt. Also, we're working on exploring some of the laws, because private contractors, sometimes they're paid by the ton. And most private businesses' main concern is lawsuits. So they're dumping and dumping salt, not understanding that it's affecting the environment and what they're doing. They're more worried about the lawsuit than their future. And if we don't do something now, our kids are going to have some really big problems that they're going to have to deal with.
And you have a student sitting here, and Christine, how do you feel on that? I mean, you're younger, you're coming up in this world, plus, you know, someday you get older, you have kids or grandkids. I mean, it's a concern, correct?
And that's why I feel that the research and the efforts that are put into these practices now is so important, because we are the future of, you know, small town communities, larger scale, you know, the country. So the research and the knowledge we gain now will only help us in the future. So hopefully we can use what we learn from this to benefit us later on.
Right, and that is why they do ask for people to support them and come up with the dollars to put into the science project to try to learn what we can do to help protect the environment. And it's not stating that we are against people have to live, we understand that, but we are looking for solutions.
We are looking for solutions and exploring solutions, and collaboration is key also. We've collaborated with the college, we've collaborated with other cities, we've collaborated with Milwaukee, Madison. It takes a village to solve a problem this complex, and as we said, the first step is education. Educating the general public, and then reaching and branching out and working together to explore different options.
We had some people passing the booth who said, oh, we use a different alternative that helps the paws of pets, because salt can harm your animals too if it gets in their paws. So even starting in small areas like that really goes a long way.
Sounds like you guys got quite a project here, but a good one and worth investing into.
Our future and our earth is always worth the investment. If we don't take care of it now, and if every person doesn't step up, every everyday individual doesn't step up and do their part, we're all going to be dealing with a situation such as Flint, Michigan, or a similar one in our own communities. So we really need to create awareness with our community and with each other, not just about this global situation, but others as well.
Is there a way that people can find you on the internet?
We do have a Facebook site. It's called Project ICE Lincoln Middle School. ICE stands for Individuals Cleaning the Environment, and our students at Lincoln Middle School actually came up with that acronym for Project ICE. Yeah, they rock. So if you go on there, we have a lot of information. We've actually had contests where other students from other schools have entered. Our contests have been won by students at St. Joe's, Summers, Lance. So that's another way that we've gotten our community involved with the project.
Phenomenal. It's just pretty hard to express, but good thing that you guys are working on.
Yeah,
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Oh, you're welcome. And I will move from this chair because I think I saw some young lady smiling over here. I think I might be in her chair.
Oh. Okay.
So you didn't save this chair for me, really.
Hey, we invite anybody to come sit down and talk with us.
All right. Well, I thank both of you very much. Christine,
thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, I'm here with Chris of Wild Ones. Mm-hmm. Chris, tell us a little bit about your project and what it's about.
Oh, sure. Wild Ones is a native plant group. We are the local chapter that is in Kenosha and Racine counties, and we our emphasis is on native landscaping. So we talk about why native plants are important in the landscape.
All right, and what do you want to educate us on a few of them?
Oh, sure. The thing that we are promoting right now is milkweed.
Milkweed, that's an important one. Monarchs.
It is, yes. Monarchs need to lay their eggs on milkweed seeds to survive. The caterpillars only eat milkweed, and so we're giving away free milkweed seeds so that people can plant them in their yards and hopefully sustain the monarch population.
Okay, and let's talk about the benefit of the monarchs and why we need them.
Monarchs are an important pollinator for a lot of plants. But really, our focus is on providing milkweed for monarchs because monarchs are just such cool organisms. They're one of the only butterflies that makes a long distance, thousands of miles of migration, and we really like to study them to find out how they know where to go back to when they fly to Mexico. That's just really awesome.
That is really cool. Yeah, and you know what? I never thought about that, but they do. They return back.
They do. They return every year, which is amazing. And we don't really understand exactly how they know.
Wow. You know, and we were just talking a little bit about some environmental destruction that goes on, and mm-hmm. some of that does affect some of the plants and affects some of the even the insects and the wildlife. So we do have to keep an eye on that. But. People taking the milkweeds uh-huh. is a good idea to keep planting them.
Yes. The more of this you can plant, the more monarchs there will be, and the better for everything.
Absolutely. And also, do you work on other things with pollinators like bees and stuff like
we
that?
We do. Yeah. We have a native plant sale the first Saturday in June, which is going to be here at Gateway. Okay. And we have... a ton of native plants, which are the best things for native pollinators, like bees, butterflies, birds, things like that.
All right. Well, let's take a look at this. I want to show the people what you got. These are, you know, you're giving these away today.
Yes.
Okay. Oh, I'm sorry. I got two of them.
It's okay.
But these are for growing milk pods. They grow, right? Correct?
Yeah. So these are milkweed seeds. This is common milkweed. They're the ones that have the big pods that you see along highways.
Right.
And so this is a really good plant for monarch butterflies because they have to lay their eggs on these.
Right.
And then the caterpillars eat this as their sole food. And then once they're adults, the adults have a lot of sources for nectar. But for the caterpillars, they have to be on these plants. So it's really important to plant milkweeds. So that's why we're giving them away.
Okay. Well, that sounds like a plan. And how long does it take for these to come up now?
Oh, they'll come up this year, and then they'll flower in the summer.
Oh, yeah. So how soon do I have to get them ground? Like right away today? Or?
Would be, well, not today, but as soon as possible.
All right.
Yeah.
All right. Well, it sounds like a game plan. I think I'll get to work on that.
And, so
are you on Facebook or anything? Can people find you? You got a website?
We do. We're the Root River Wild Ones chapter. So you just search for us. We're not a closed group. Anybody can like us. Like us today.
All right. Get out there and like the Wild Ones.
Root River Wild Ones.
Wild Ones. Okay. All right. That'll work. Thank you very much.
Bye.
All right. I'm standing here with Nancy in Kenosha of the Kenosha Public Museum, but you're also involved with some of the other projects like the Great Lakes Project, Lake Michigan Project.
Well, actually, these are some of the activities that we've done at the museum, as well as one of the activities from our school group program, Lake Michigan, Our Source of Water. So being right on the lake, the Kenosha Public Museums are really concerned about the health of Lake Michigan. So many of the programs and activities we do help to educate people about why it's important to not leave your trash at the beach, remove water from your boat so you're not transporting invasive species to other bodies of water.
Right, and there's been a lot of that throughout the years. We had run into you earlier today, and you were talking about how a lot of these species are hitchhikers.
Yeah, they are hitchhikers. Most of the invasive species came over, at least the ones that are in the lake, came over in the ballast water of ships from Europe and Asia. And then when those ships get to North America, they dump their ballast water, and of course the hitchhikers get dumped into our water system.
And I know now, you guys are working on some of the projects to try to put a stop to some of this?
Well, the museum, not directly. We're just more educating people about the invasives that are in Lake Michigan and about the efforts of the DNR and the EPA to try and stop, particularly like the Asian carp, to from keeping them from getting into Lake Michigan. They're getting pretty close, but so far efforts have been successful to keep them out.
Right, and that is a big one. I know that they have the barriers, the electrical barriers, to help try to stop them in Chicago. And,
right.
If they can keep them contained, that would be nice, but that's a problem.
Right, and I know my brother lives in central Illinois, and they actually have Asian carp rodeos because the fish jump out of the water, so they try and catch them.
Yeah.
And I know that there's a lot of efforts among chefs in Chicago to find ways to use the Asian carp to make them a food source.
Right. Well, they could have quite a food source because they multiply pretty good.
Yes, they do. And if you see some of the videos on YouTube, you can see anytime they're in the area jumping out of the water, there are just massive amounts of Asian carp.
Right. I do have some information on that on my website at outdoorwild.com on Asian carp. It's not a lot, but it's a little bit. It gives people an idea of where to go to. But do you guys contain any information that people can find?
Actually, we usually just go to the DNR website or EPA. Those seem to be the best resources.
Very good resources, yes. You have some stuff back here, Nancy, that shows a little bit of zebra mussel and things like that.
Yeah, this is actually some sand from Eichelman Beach.
Okay.
Just to show the density of zebra mussels. Zebra mussels, again, are an invasive species in Lake Michigan.
Right.
There's also another mussel called quagga mussel that's an invasive. And they're filter feeders, so they're eating the microscopic organisms that live in the water. They're making the water look very clear, but that's not necessarily a good thing because they're removing the food source from the native organisms in the water.
That's very, very interesting.
And we also have some round gobies here. Round gobies, again, are another invasive species. A fisherman caught these in the harbor near the Civil War Museum and brought them over to the museum, wanted to know if I wanted them.
Okay.
And so I preserved them in alcohol. There was a woman here just a minute ago, and she said, oh, yeah, we pull those out all the time. I said, well, pull them out and take them out because she said, yeah, they're just really abundant.
I was unaware of these. So now he just caught these on a hook, or how did he catch them?
On a hook, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
So
and the woman that was here said she, yeah, you just put your line down and you can pull these out all the time. So.
And what do these do to the lake then?
They eat some of the smaller organisms that are part of the natural food chain in the lake. So we don't like these.
No, because the one thing people need to understand is when you go into that, you're talking things that multiply like crazy and can really do some damage.
Exactly. Right.
You start losing plankton. The things that they eat up, that's
exactly.
Our fish.
The phytoplankton, the zooplankton, so that's what the zebra mussels are eating.
Right.
And then takes that, you know, organism out of the food chain, and then the smaller organisms that feed on them are hurt, and it just keeps going up to the larger ones. So, you know, if the Asian carp get in, they're really going to do some damage to the game fish.
Yeah. Yeah.
And basically destroy the ecosystem of the lake.
Exactly, exactly. Yeah. Something we don't need.
No, we don't.
Something nobody needs.
Exactly.
So. All right. Well, thank you very much.
Thanks, Dean. All right.
Okay, and this is the 9/11 survivor tree that Jane was talking about. And very interesting. Last year it was brought here and we did a little coverage on it. And what's really good about this tree is it marks a day in America. It was tragic to a lot of us. But it is the 9/11 survivor tree, and it's involved. We had military veterans here last year, and a lot of people here last year that was in on the coverage of this tree. So, and we're really proud to say that we are one of the only shows carrying this tree, or the only show carrying this tree. So we're pretty proud to show that. But yeah, this is the tree from 9/11, and it's doing quite well. So we're very proud of that here at Gateway Tech in Kenosha, Wisconsin. Come on out and see it. I'm here with Kate, and you were involved with us earlier. We were doing a little mustard ball. Let's start.
Right, right. We did a Pike Creek cleanup where we picked up garbage, and we also pulled garlic mustard, which is an invasive weed. And got our hands smelling like garlic, which was wonderful.
All right, now you're with the Gateway Urban Farm.
Yes, I am. I'm the director of the Urban Farm, and we are starting an on-campus market this year that will run on Thursdays from 1 to 6, and we're going to have music and kids' activities and all kinds of educational activities, garden clinics, in addition to our wonderful produce, free-range eggs, and honey, local honey.
That's a great thing. Now, do you guys market this outside of Gateway, or is it just strictly here?
We're just doing it on the Gateway campus, but it is open to the public. So we will we'll have information out there for the public for the market. So come one, come all. We'd love to have everybody on. Come join us.
Sounds good. Is there a way that people can find you online if they want any information?
gtc.edu/horticulture and also gtc.edu/urban farm, and you can find all the information. We're also on Facebook now, so the information is out there.
All right. And am I pronouncing your name? I said Kate. Is that right?
Kate Jerome, yes.
I did pronounce right. Good for me. All right, well, Kate, thank you very much.
Thank you. Enjoy your day.
You will. Thank you. All right. I'm standing here with Lee at Gateway Tech. And Lee, explain to us what you have going on here today.
So this is the barn area, the Center for Sustainable Living area. We have a lot of children's activities going on here today. The barn activities are focused on trees this year, trees and forest.
Okay.
So we have such activities as, does it come from a tree? We have some emerald ash borer type of activities. We do have a water activity from Mike Shuck, who is in charge of our wastewater treatment program, but he is sort of focused it in on plants that grow in water. We have Richard Bong Naturals area, and they have their animals in here today. And then we have several students from Mahone Middle School who have brought microscopes and other activities, again, focusing in on trees, plants, and that type of that's a focus for here today.
All right, a little more information on the emerald ash borer beetle and at Gateway Tech here. We're with a student, correct? What school are you?
I'm from Lakeview Technology Academy, but I'm associated with Mahone Eco Club.
Okay, and what's your name?
My name's Anish.
All right, Anish, well, educate us a little bit here. What do we got going on with, what do you guys got set up?
Well, right here we have a couple poster boards, basically just giving some information on the emerald ash borer. What this insect does is it burrows inside of trees, and it basically internally kills the trees. They breed inside and they hatch eggs that then go on to infestate different trees around the area.
Right, and for a lot of folks that don't know, and I was a little bit unaware of the size of the emerald ash borer beetle. Well, I found out after fully growing, it's smaller than this penny. This beetle, this is mainly ash trees, but it's killed thousands of them.
Yes, it's a huge problem in the community. The very small insect, as he mentioned, being about half the size of a penny, basically did all this damage. So if that small insect could do all this damage, the entire colony of them would be able to easily take off. It's good to stay knowledgeable, it's good to know what's happening so that we can take action and take the steps to get rid of these invasive species.
And what's your name?
Abby.
Abby?
Yeah.
So what they do is they lay their eggs, and the larva is what goes through the tree.
Yeah.
They slowly form into this insect, which is smaller than a penny.
Here you can see where the emerald ash borer actually went into the tree. There's a little circle right there where the emerald ash borer actually went in.
I think you guys are doing a phenomenal job. Come on in. I'm really glad to meet you, and keep up the good work.
Thank you.
Thank you.